Hello. Welcome to the continuing series on Bergson and his holographic theory of mind. This is part 8A, Einstein and special relativity. There'll be a part B, as it's a longer subject than I hoped. In this part 8A, we'll be discussing the inconsistency of the current interpretation of special relativity theory, STR, special theory of relativity, the strange status, contradictory status of its effects. The twin paradox is an intrinsic part of this difficulty. And we'll be looking at the general theory, GTR, which is often appealed to as an escape from the dilemmas of the special theory, as of actuality, no help in the problem. So how did this start? Particularly, how did it start for Bergson? Well, with Langevin, Paul Langevin, at a 1911 Congress, the Congress of Bologna, and he announced the twin paradox. To him, it was a remarkable implication of Einstein's special relativity. In the paradox, a twin boards a rocket traveling at high speed near the velocity of light and heads for a faraway star. His brother is left on Earth, in this case playing poker, because he has to have something to do. When the rocket riding brother returns, behold, the rocket brother looks like Brad Pitt at 20, and the earthbound twin has gray hair, sitting in a wheelchair perhaps, wrinkles, a long gray beard, and arthritis from in his hands from playing incessant poker. So why the paradox? Well, according to special relativity, each sees the other as moving. So in other words, each observer, each twin can declare himself at rest and the other twin in motion. So each should paradoxically find the other to have aged more slowly. Yet Langevin resolved this situation entirely in favor of the rocket twin, as though the Earth twin has no say. The Earth twin's just got to age, and it's not the rocket twin that's going to age. So Bergson, at this point in time, in 1922, was already retired, having left the academic scene, feeling that he was had gained so much attention due to his notoriety as a very famous individual that he was causing difficulties. But this particular situation eventually caught his attention, this interpretation of special relativity. For him, something had just gone very wrong with relativity, and it carried enormous implications for the nature of time. So in 1922, Bergson wrote his book, Duration and Simultaneity, with reference to Einstein's theory. He described it thusly: to get at this, that is the true meaning of relativity, we went over the Lorentz formulae term by term, we being Bergson, in his use of the plural always, and the Lorentz formulae being the equations that describe the changes of time and space for the twins. Seeking the concrete reality, the perceived or perceptible thing to which each term corresponded. In other words, to get at the true deep semantics and meaning of the mathematics. This examination gave a quite unexpected result. Not only did Einstein's thesis no longer appear to contradict the natural belief in a single universal time, but they even corroborated it. Now, when he says he went over the term-by-term case for the system, I mean, he really broke down Einstein's system when you look at duration and simultaneity. This was quite an analysis, and unappreciated today, of course. In fact, this entire subject I'm going to note right now is often cited as part of Bergson's demise. To quote one critic, the best explanation for Bergson's impressive failure as a scientific theoretician is the same as that for his failure to succeed as a metaphysician. He was not sufficiently conversant with the outlook and problems of mathematics and physics, unquote. The difficulty with this is Henri was no slouch. He had won a prestigious prize in mathematics in France at the age of 18. His mentor, de Boves, remarked, "You might have been a mathematician, but you'll only be a philosopher." In other words, his mentor saw his mathematical promise. This is also not the view of de Broglie, the founder of quantum wave mechanics, and other physicists who realized that Bergson had foreseen the impending crisis in the foundations of classical physics. As I say elsewhere in my books, in truth, the impressive failure is the failure to realize what Bergson was saying. Moving on from this aside, in the same year of 1922, Bergson engaged with Einstein in a spontaneous discussion under the auspices of the Société de Philosophie. Acquiescing to an invitation to make an impromptu comment, Bergson gave about 15 minutes of remarks, and then Einstein responded. We'll go into this exchange later in Part 8b. It's a significant exchange. This actually began a period of controversy over the nature of time and the meaning of special relativity. The characters in the debates are chronicled and painted in great detail, exquisite detail, in The Physicist and the Philosopher, namely being Einstein and Bergson, by Jimena Canales. From a tapestry of history being richly described, this is a book. Unfortunately, Jimena chose not to explain the structure and substance of the argument. Now, forwarding 50 years plus, 1972-ish for me, this is how it got started for me, because I was asking, well, how does SDR reconcile with Bergson and his view of the nature of time and a four-dimensional being? Because, as we noted, Bergson remarking that he thought that relativity saved the concept of the natural flow of time for all, what relativity actually is construed to be saying is that there's what's called the space-time block, where everything is laid out, future, present, and past, in one frozen block. That is, there's actually no change. This is a subject we'll be going into. So that's one thing that hangs there in your mind. Again, another is, well, are the effects of special relativity actually real, actually physical, or ontological in the philosophical term, where ontos, the Greek, means being, or are these effects having actual being? Because if the effects are real, then so is the relativity of simultaneity, and it's the relativity of simultaneity that is implying the reality of the frozen block universe of future, present, and past all laid out. If there's any such thing as future, present, and past, everything gets quite problematic, as we shall see. So why this question? Why did this question even arise, this status of the effects? Well, as soon as you go into the literature, you start seeing this dilemma. The twin effect is considered very real, as Langevin came down on the nature of the SDR's implications. That is, the Earth twin has a beard, he's aging, he's sick, he can barely beat Brad Pitt with his cane, whereas the rocket twin looks like Brad Pitt, very young, no wrinkles, etc. In other words, this is a very real, very ontological, very physical effect between the two. The difference is stark. But as you read about the Michelson-Morley experiment, which special relativity was supposed to explain, the contraction of the apparatus arm of the Michelson-Morley experiment is all important. And that contraction is considered not real, not physical, not ontological, but a measurement effect only. So the question becomes, will the real nature of special relativity's effects please stand up? This one discovers is extremely difficult to ascertain. Let's look at the Michelson-Morley experiment, 1887. In the context of the time, the ether was considered as the medium of the transmission of energy waves, just as the water is a propagation of waves of water. And the earth was conceived as a boat plowing through the ether. Therefore, it should be possible, they thought, to measure the velocity of the earth, like measuring the bow wave of the earth. So the Michelson-Morley experiment involved two pipes, shall we say, a light emitter, and the beam was sent out by the light wave emitter, split by the mirror. Both waves went to each mirror and bounced back, and then they would be recorded at another device. And what they were looking for is an interference pattern or not. Now, in fundamental Pythagorean math, what you have, if you have a beam going crosswise to the current, as we're showing up there, the ether current, as opposed to a wave going down the current and back up against the current, is a little computation that shows that the ray going with the current and back, the parallel wave, takes longer. So we would expect an interference pattern because the rays, the waves, will be out of sync. Like this wave right here, well, these two waves are out of sync. Crest is not meeting crest, trough not meeting trough. Were they perfectly in sync, you'd have a perfect match between those two waves. Well, could not distinguish crest and trough. But with the wave taking longer, going up and down against the ether current and back, we're going to get an interference pattern from the interference of these two waves. So this experiment was done, and the result was considered remarkable because there was no interference pattern. And the dilemma became, what's the conclusion? Is it that the Earth is not moving? Or is the ether not understood? Or something else? Remember, the whole notion was that the Earth is moving through the ether, and therefore there has to be an effect on that beam parallel to the ether with the ether current. And we saw no effect. One conclusion would be, the Earth isn't moving at all then. Or something else. Now, Hendrik Lorentz in 1892 came up with a possible solution, and that is that the parallel to the current arm is contracting, and it contracts just enough to account for the travel time difference. So you just have to contract it a little bit, and both beams arrive back then at the same time. The parallel beam, the beam going with the current, doesn't have to go quite as far as the other beam, and therefore it gets back in time in reality. So just have to contract that apparatus arm. And Lorentz offered electrodynamical arguments for the contraction. He had a physical base for this argument. It wasn't exactly mysterious. As I said, electrodynamical arguments for the contraction. His equations, called the Lorentz equations, expressed the degree of contraction and accounted for the same travel times. So he had the equations for this, and his equations looked exactly like Einstein's would later in 1905. always leading to a strange argument as to whether or not Einstein kind of just appropriated these equations. But that's neither here nor there at this point. But the contraction was unappealing to physics. It just seemed ad hoc. It was rejected, or at least never accepted. And you can see Wiki on the Lorentz contraction. So the question was, well, why was Einstein's contraction using precisely the same equations accepted? And the answer is because the length of that apparatus arm became a space-time invariant. Sounds very sophisticated. So how do we get to the space-time invariant? Well, it relates to fundamental problems of measurement. So hang with me here. Suppose Einstein had argued, two lightning bolts strike on either side of you, fortunately a safe 1,000 meters away. You have two clocks placed in your system. Both are perfectly synchronized to the millisecond. Now I've shown little mirrors there where the lightning bolts strike, the light bounces off the mirror, strikes the clock, and the clock stops. So the lightning bolts stop the clocks at precisely the same time, at 2 o'clock according to those clock readings. So you say, given the distance between the mirrors and the clocks were exactly equal, that the bolts were simultaneous. But suppose another observer, we'll call him Observer 2, is moving on a large flying disk, that is his reference system, at some velocity right past where you stand, say 5,000 miles an hour. Observer 2 is moving on an exact line towards the bolt on the right and away from the bolt on the left. So here he comes. Now, assuming that the lightning bolts strike roughly when Observer 2, the gray guy, was coincident with the position where Observer 1, the green guy, is, so roughly in the center of the bolts, we'll note that things happen a little differently, because Observer 2 has synchronized clocks. But note that for this moving observer, the light from the bolt and the mirror on the right will stop the clock a little sooner, since he's traveling towards it. So here's the light from the bolt, when the bolt hit on the right. And since he's moving in that direction, when the light hits the mirror and travels toward the clock, since the clock is moving toward that bolt, it's not going to take so long for the light to stop the clock as in the stationary system. And simultaneously, as the bolt on the left hit and the light travels toward the clock, that clock is traveling away from the bolt, so it takes a little longer. So the clock stops at different times. So this observer declares the two lightning bolts not simultaneous. Now surely we ask, well, he must know that he is moving. This explains the difference easily. He would be able to adjust his watches accordingly. But, said Einstein, perhaps he does not know that he is moving. Perhaps he thinks he is at rest. Perhaps he really is at rest. Perhaps it is you who are moving. How do we know? This became the essence of the first of two major postulates proposed by Einstein and which underpin his theory. This is relativity. The first postulate is stated as the laws of physics are the same invariant in all inertial reference frames. This can equally be called the reciprocity of reference systems. Now, when I use the word reciprocity in discussions with people like on Amazon reviews about physics books, I'll get snide or remarks, shall we say, on, I never heard that term before, reciprocity. And that's because, of course, they never studied the literature in the 70s or 60s or 50s, apparently, before they got all their physics knowledge from current physics books. Reciprocity is a very cool word describing what's going on. This implies that any observer has the right to declare himself at rest and all others in motions with respect to him. Everything is reciprocal. There is no way to tell who is right. Now, the second postulate, just for the record, is that the invariance of the velocity of light in all inertial frames. Light is always the same speed, 186,000 miles per second, in all frames, all references. So for both observer one and observer two, one moving, one stationary, or vice versa, the velocity of light is the same for both, according to Einstein. So where do the expanded time units and contracted space units come from? And I say that because these are what underlie the twins, the rocket twins, retarded aging or time slowing down. Expanded time units or contracted space units. Well, since observer two doesn't realize he is in motion, according to you, his clocks are not actually in sync. Notice for observer one there, those two clocks both show 2 o'clock precisely. They're both in sync. You had no problem syncing them because you weren't in motion. At least you didn't think you were. But for observer two, the method by which he must synchronize his clocks, Einstein showed, would be affected by his motion. One of his clocks will lag behind the other. So now we see observer two up there, and we note that one clock is 2 o'clock and one clock is 3 o'clock. So the 2 o'clock clock is lagging behind the other clock in that system. And he nevertheless thinks they're in sync, but you say no, they're not. Because of his measurements of distances and time within his own moving system, because of this, his measurements of distance and time within his own moving system will be affected. So Einstein derived equations, suspiciously like the Lorentz equations, to allow us, as observer one, to coordinate observer two's measurements of distance and times to our measures of distance and time. In fact, to specify what his measurements will look like in his system in terms of distance and time values. So the distance values for his x-axis now become x prime, and the time values in his system, or time units, become t prime. And I'm showing the equations up there. Yeah, in the right there for the Lorentz equations for T prime and X prime. Central to these equations is a constant for both systems, the velocity of light, C. So you can see the C and the T prime equation up there, the C squared. Where you can't see it is that little G should be a gamma, but I couldn't find the nice Greek gamma. And that also has C in it for the adjustment of those two factors. Note already in those equations that x is always a function of t and t a function of x. You see x and t in each equation. This says something very important, that time and distance are intricately, inseparably bound in these equations. So applying these equations to observer two and his reference system, we would assign him expanded time units, T prime, relative to ours, and we would also assign him contracted distance units, or X prime units. So at this point, one can intuitively understand why these distance and time change phenomena might be called measurement differences. There are seeming squabbles over clock settings due to motion. But the problem of just who is in motion is very real. Observer two, invoking reciprocity, can declare himself to be the system at rest. And then he can, of course, use the same Lorentz equations for our, what we thought to be, stationary system. and our distance and time values, claiming we are in motion and our clocks are out of sync, and he can derive x prime and t prime for us. So let's look more intuitively at what a measurement effect is. I measure my toaster with two different rulers. My one ruler, blue ruler here, is 9 inches, so the toaster is 9 inches. I have another ruler that's yellow, and it's 5.5 inches. So the toaster is 9 inches with this ruler. It contracts to 5 inches, 5.5 inches with this ruler, and expands again to 9 inches with this ruler. So the toaster expands 9 inches, contracts to 5 inches, expands to 9 inches. Is this a real contraction or a real expansion? Is there any ontological status, actual status of being, physical being here? No, it is a measurement effect, a rather ridiculous measurement effect of the expando toaster. The only difference between this and STR, this and special relativity, is this. Instead of rulers, we are using light rays and clocks for our measures. These are the rulers, the light rays and clocks. Beyond that, we have no difference. Now, back to the notion of the simultaneity or relative simultaneity of events. The strikes of the two lightning bolts are now relativized in this view. They happen at the same time for one observer, but at different times for another observer. The events that seem simultaneous to us may not be for another person, the moving observer too. This means that what are simultaneous events for one observer may be successive events for another. That's to say, drilling down, that two simultaneous events for one observer may for another be one event in his future, the other in his past. But what does this mean for the flow of time? Well, ultimately we're going to see nothing. But in the relativity story, it means a great deal in current interpretation. So back to Michelson-Morley and the famous length as a space-time invariant pronunciation that solved the ether problem. How does the length become such an invariant? That is not a true contraction, but a space-time invariant. That is not a real ontological contraction of the apparatus arm. It does so by being subject to the reciprocal transformations of two observers in two different reference systems, either of which can consider himself at rest and the other in motion. And this in conjunction with the joint compensation of increased time intervals for decreased space intervals, or units of measure. So we see right here in his 1905 paper where he describes the reciprocity. He notes a spear, which at rest would be a spear in a non-moving system, is seen as an ellipsoid in the moving system. And he notes that the radius of the spear is contracted, that this is the length contraction, by a certain amount, and we turn the spear, therefore, into an ellipsoid, as we can see in the little pictures there. So one spear versus one ellipsoid. Then he notes the reciprocity, to quote, "It is clear that the same results hold good of bodies at rest in the stationary system viewed from a system in uniform motion." So now the moving system becomes a stationary system, and we have the spear in the observer 2's formerly moving system, and we have the ellipsoid now in the what was once a stationary system. So we have reciprocity. So Einstein's perceived advance over Lorentz was to embed the Lorentz transformations within this symmetric reciprocal framework, together with postulating the invariance of the velocity of light. So there was no longer a length in and of itself in the new relativistic view or perspective. Rather, there was a space-time length composed of varying amounts of space and time. Remember, these are integral and intrinsically compensating. The total, shall we say, being an invariant. So I have a simple example here. If I have a value of 5 for space and a value of time for 5, I get a total of 10. If I have a value of 7 for space, I've got to have time for 3 and a total of 10. I've got total of space-time contribution always being the same, but I can have different amounts of each of space and time as these transformations occur. So indeed, Einstein actually wished that his theory had been named invariantin theory rather than relativity. Because in special relativity, the Lorentz transformations have no meaning with respect to just one observer. There is no invariance with just one observer. Some form of transformation is required for an invariant. This symmetric system is required in order to have a space-time invariant. And within it, either observer can declare himself at rest and then attribute the length contraction to the other, who is in motion, adjusting the other space and time units to preserve the invariance of the velocity of light. So, multi years later, 1968, A.P. French, an MIT physicist, took pains to explain this in his textbook on special relativity. He noted STR, special relativity, cannot be used to explain real ontological effects. That is, special relativity does not explain and cannot be used to explain changes either of length or of time intervals as a property of matter, as something really physical, actual, ontological. It only describes measurement effects, or as he put it, something inherent in the measurement process, like our toaster, something inherent in the measurement process. In other words, STR's effects are effects with no ontological status. But back to 1972, in the textbooks I studied in the 1970s, trying to figure out what's going on, the explanations of length contraction routinely told this story. What we just went through, the length contraction is not real. It is an effective measurement only, like the toaster. The length is a space-time invariant. But no single observer has a claim on knowing the true length, because, of course, no single observer knows whether he's in motion or at rest. The student is warned not to fall into the length contraction is real trap. In truth, we must remember there is little choice. To say that the effect is a real effect is to say the Michelson-Morley apparatus arm is actually contracting somehow. So we're continually beaten over the head. Not real, not real, not real. As Earl is getting beaten on the head there by the baby. This was a story. If we actually revert or hold that the arm is contracting, we revert back to Lorentz in his hypothesized contraction, a real contraction with a real physical model at its base and the very thing physics refused previously to accept. So as you can get the picture here, there is a immovable barrier to physics to saying the contraction is anything other than a measurement contraction like our toaster. because otherwise they have no explanation for the Michelson-Morley experiment. Keep that in mind. But suddenly, when you hit time, everything changes. All of a sudden, the changes become ontological. As soon as the textbook turned to expanded time units or time dilation, a different story. The problem was that there were real physical phenomena to which time dilation appeared to be physics' only available explanation. Mesons, or muons, again, mesons being another term that seems quaint to people today, but was the term back when I was studying it. These little mesons are particles that have a certain lifespan. At rest, they exist for a certain measurable period before they decay away. When moving at high velocity, it was discovered they exist for a longer period. They live longer, they have a longer lifespan. When Lorentz's original equations for T prime are applied to this case, the increased time is perfectly predicted. Therefore, time dilation is considered a quite real effect, and the Lorentz equations of special relativity is considered to have a wonderful attribute of explaining these. If there is a doubt that this is considered a very real effect, we can propose a test. We could set up a tiny electric switch the distance from the start of the meson's motion. The distance away, let's say the switch is down by the Earth there where the observer is standing on the Earth, the distance is just long enough that if the electron is not living any longer beyond its normal rest life, it won't set off the switch. But if it's living longer by falling toward the Earth at a high velocity, it'll make it to the switch and set off the alarm clock. The ringing of the clock is a very real effect, and physics would quite surely accept that the meson will ring the clock if given the chance to live long enough. It's a very real effect. The slow aging Brad Pitt-like rocket twin versus the gray and bearded Earth twin is simply another case of the time dilation being considered a very real effect. You don't make the old gray guy there that's barely able to beat Brad Pitt with his cane versus Brad Pitt-like guy go away simply by remembering reciprocity. It can't happen. So there are two problems with all of this. The first problem is that this is ignoring reciprocity. It ignores the reciprocity of reference systems. One could put a tiny physicist on the meson, as the picture shows, and he should be able to say, I'm not in motion, you are. I will never make the clock ring. There's my tiny physicist on the meson, and the Earth is now moving toward the meson. Bergson used this example to try to drill in the intrinsic nature of reciprocity and why you cannot declare the meson to be explained this way. And later A.P. French also explained why these are not real effects, also used this exact example. Now, the rocket riding twin has perfect right to declare himself at rest, and the Earth twin in motion. The fact that he is on the rocket is of no account. The rocket engines could be considered to be holding the rocket's place in space as the Earth moves away from the rocket and then back again. Einstein even noted this in his discussion on the subject in 1918, where he was trying to preserve reciprocity somehow and yet have his cake and eat it too, allow the twins to differentially age. So he proceeded to blame the increase of the Earth twin, or the increased Earth twin aging, the more rapid aging of the Earth twin, on massive gravitational field changes required to stop the Earth and turn it back again toward to where it originated. In truth, however, the mathematics of relativity per se is abstract and these type of physical considerations are irrelevant to it. Only the abstract mathematics relating the two reference systems, the Lorentz equations, invariance of C, and the time and distance change units involved are relevant. The rest is not. Secondly, if it's gravitational fields that are causing the increased or more rapid aging in the Earth twin, one would require, in reality, a theory of how gravitational fields interact with physiological processes, and more precisely, how gravitational fields and changes thereof, whatever that might mean, increase the rate of aging in a physiological system. And of course, you would have the vice versa problem then with the rocket. So, of course, none of these types of actual physical considerations is ever in appearance in this entire discussion. Only the abstract reciprocity of reference systems is important in special relativity. So now it is the Earth twin who ages less. He moves back and forth to the rocket. So for whom is the aging less, the Earth guy or the rocket guy? Has time really changed for either? Or should, just like for the meson, or should we be saying that the aging period too is a space-time invariant just as the length contraction? Now we're getting into the very essence, and I'm just reconstructing Bergson's argument, desperately trying to get physics to re-regard the reciprocity inherent in Einstein's system. But fast forward, the phenomena keep building up against holding reciprocity, or building up against physics psychology of holding reciprocity. An experiment in 1971 known as the Halfley-Keating experiment. It was ultimately performed in which a clock was put on the jet and flown at great speed, actually around the planet. Forgot to note that here. When the jet landed, the clock was compared to a previously synchronized counterpart clock left on the ground. The jet clock lagged behind, and the Lorentz equation for the time, or the expanded time intervals, accounted for the difference. Another apparent triumph or confirmation for relativity. And of course, when the experimenters stepped off the jet with their retarded clock, no one stepped forward and argued for reciprocity. That is, that in actuality, the jet was at rest and the Earth was moving at extreme speed relative to the jet, and just came back to the same position where the jet was. Thus it is the Earth-based observer's clocks that should be retarded, not the jet-carried clock. Well, why didn't they make this argument? Because it's obviously absurd. These are very real effects. They cannot be made to go away by invoking reciprocity. If the longer living meson rings the alarm clock, the ringing is very real. It cannot be said that the clock isn't ringing by suddenly remembering reciprocity. The bearded twin, should it happen, would be very real, and the beard would not go away by remembering reciprocity. The symmetry implied by reciprocity clearly has been broken. The second problem is time and space changes must be of the same order, something I started to warn you about several slides ago. In the system in which Einstein embedded the Lorentz transformations, space changes compensate for time changes and vice versa, depending on the motions of the observers. To quote Bergson, in the theory of relativity, the slowing of clocks is only as real as the shrinkage of objects by distance. So what he's saying is clocks slow only in proportion as objects shrink or distances shrink. the two are absolutely tied, as I noted in the equations over on the right there too. X and t are in both equations. Distance and time are in both equations. This is why there are only space-time invariants in Einstein's system. The space changes are simply compensating for time changes. That is, if space units, length units are contracting in proportion to time units are expanding, there's no way the two forms of changes can have differing ontological status. Either both are ontological or both are not ontological. That is, in the non-ontological case, then they are simply measurement effects. And if you're going to hold that Michelson-Morley is a measurement effect, well, you're forced to hold that the time changes, be it twin aging, muon agings, jet carried clocks, are also measurement effects. But of course, you see, the difficulty is here is that they can't. But relativity was accepted precisely on the basis that Einstein showed Michelson-Morley to be a measurement effect. The apparatus was not actually physically foreshortening in the direction of the ether motion, as Lorentz had suggested. So this physics accepted space changes as non-ontological. It is inescapably then, as I've already said, including time changes as non-ontological. This should end the story on the reality of the changes in time, period. In other words, they should be looking for a new theory. Unbelievably, it did not. As far as I can ascertain, in the 1980s, perhaps earlier, another paradox began appearing in the textbooks called the Pohl-Bohren paradox. In this paradox, the notion was now being applied to the length contraction. In the paradox, we have a longish, say, telephone pole at rest. In its resting state, it's too long to fit inside a certain barn. However, when the pole is launched into motion at a velocity near the speed of light and flies through the barn, there is a period where the pole, due to its length contraction, actually fits inside the barn. But this paradox is used as a parable for illustrating that we should not consider these real effects. It is unhesitatingly pointed out that the barn could be conceived to be in motion. So, reciprocity. Reciprocity unhesitatingly invoked, and therefore the barn will contract. Now the pole does not fit, because the barn is contracted. It already didn't fit. So the length contractions are not real, or in philosophical terms, they have no ontological status. And this nicely holds the line with the interpretation of the Michelson-Morley experiment, of course, ignoring everything else regarding time that they want to call ontological. One could ask something, however. Just like the jet-carried clock experiment, why not perform a Pohl-Bohren experiment? I'm just sort of sticking it to them here. We could rig a mini barn-like apparatus with a front end and back end doors that open and shut at great speed, or some analogy thereof, light detectors, something. The device would capture a mini pole moving at high velocity precisely when it fits inside the barn, or the little mini barn, due to its length contraction. If we can so unhesitatingly predict that the jet-carried clock will slow down, if we're so sure those are ontological effects, the clock slowing down, the actual effect on the clock apparatus, why would we not predict that the mini pole would contract and be trapped inside the barn? Well, we know why, because that would be admitting that the length contraction too is a very real effect. It would end the pretense of any usage of the reciprocity of reference systems aspect of the special theory. So at present, physics deploys the reciprocity feature for length contractions and unhesitatingly dumps the feature for time expansion. It therefore rejects the relativization of simultaneity as real and simultaneously, or not simultaneously, accepts the relativization of simultaneity as real, along with its block universe implication. This is the sorry state of affairs. And that, as I have said clearly in these slides already, in truth, physics needs a new theory to explain these very real effects. Special relativity cannot do it. So the contraction, or the contradiction, is boggling. If the Meson rings the bell, if the twin has a beard and wrinkles, if the pole is caught in the barn, if the pole gains enough mass to obliterate the barn, none of these effects can be undone. They cannot be subject to reciprocity. And thus, STR is utterly inapplicable. A new theory is needed. The reciprocity is utterly inapplicable, and the intrinsic reciprocity of STR is inapplicable. So, GTR, does it really come to the rescue? Those knowledgeable in this area may say, what, the twin paradox must be assigned to the general theory. This is due, it is thought by some, to the accelerations involved with the rocket. Einstein's general theory, which was developed after the special theory, deals with gravity and acceleration. This is obviously acceptable, obviously a questionable assertion on face value. If it is the twin's beard, that is the real physical, obviously non-symmetric effect displayed in the aging that we are worried about, then the jet-carried clock and the Meson's increased lifespans must be sent to the GTR as well. These are just as real and just as non-symmetric. In other words, all such effects must be moved into GTR. This leaves the explanatory effectiveness of special theory as zero. Remember, STR's reputation is due to these confirmations. The Halfley-Keating jet-carried clock experiment, the explaining of Mesons and their increased lifespan, and a few other things I haven't thrown in that are equally and just as problematic. Suffice it to say for now that this gambit going into GTR only adds confusion when quickly discovers that there is an explanatory P being shuffled between the general theory and the special theory. And we'll deal with this P in a bit. So half relativity is what Bergson termed in his duration and simultaneity work, the asymmetric use of STR, where the Lorentz equations are applied to the Meson, the lifespan increase falls out via T prime, end of explanation. In other words, we have a one-way application of the Lorentz equations to one system, but not to the other. As noted already, A.P. French, in his section trying to keep clarity, called relativity is truly relative, which is to say you've got to take into consideration reciprocity, flatly stated that the time dilation, just as the length contraction of Michelson-Morley, as observed for a Meson, is not a property of matter, but something inherent in the measurement process, that is, like the toaster. So French goes to the rare extent of actually showing two Minkowski diagrams, one for each observer, as though there were a small observer on the Meson, showing the symmetry of the changes in each system. Now, I haven't talked at all about Minkowski diagrams, but if you look at the one that says observer on Earth, for example, what we see in the nice orthogonal or right angle axes, the major axes, X and T, represent the stationary system, and then those two angled axes, T1 and T2, X2 there, are the moving system. They represent the moving system, its axes, and the rhombus, you can see, represents the changes in time and space units, respectively, for the moving system. And I'll note that it's rather endemic in the relativity literature to see the use of Minkowski diagram, not diagrams. That is, we represent or show one Minkowski diagram, and that's the end of the story. We'd only see the observer under your diagram. And again, representing the complete failure to factor in reciprocity. As Bergson noted in these Minkowski diagrams, they are truly incapable of expressing the whole situation. The major axes express the observer that's stationary, and everyone else is put in place with respect to him. If we want to use the Minkowski diagram to represent the observer, the other observer's side, we have to have an Minkowski diagram for him. That is, in this case, the observer on the meson, and then we express the fact that he is now stationary and all other observers in the universe are in motion with respect to him. So again, I warn, the Minkowski diagram is often misused in these arguments and fails utterly to show the reciprocity that's required. So just as Bergson argued earlier, French notes that for an observer to compute T prime as the meson falls to the Earth, the tiny observer in the meson is equally allowed to compute T prime for the observer on Earth, the physicist moving up toward him, saying that he, the meson observer, is stationary, and the physicist on the Earth moving upward towards the meson. This is to say, again, we have here, in French's terms, a measurement effect. Now, I know too that French is arguing that special relativity can only treat this meson lifespan, longer lifespan effect, as a measurement effect. In retrospect, we know that this is taken unequivocally as a real effect. And French was, in effect, kind of ignoring that this was a real effect, at minimum saying, well, relativity can't explain it. So when French wants to treat the twin paradox, he finds himself between a rock and a hard place, because he wants to try to incorporate the idea that the twin will age more slowly on the rocket and age more quickly on the Earth, a real effect. But he's just got done showing that relativity can't explain these types of effects as real effects, to the point of his double Minkowski diagrams. So what he does is invoke the asymmetry introduced when the twin on the rocket turns around to return, therefore introducing a new inertial frame. So as the rocket leaves the Earth and heads towards the star, it's in frame one. That's the inertial frame one. When he turns around, he comes back to the Earth, he's now in inertial frame two. So a new inertial frame. So Lorentz, T prime, is then used to compute the shorter times of the traveling twin for each leg of the trip. So he breaks the two legs of the trip down into two uniform velocity paths and computes the time retardation for each path, adds it up, and of course, ends up showing that the Earth twin ages more than the rocket twin. And again, remember that he has to get it down to uniform velocities because Lorentz-Einstein only deals with uniform velocity, not accelerations. So in conjunction with this then is the asymmetry introduced by the turnaround that is required to support the real aging effect as a real property of matter. And of course, we're struck by the fortuitousness, the almost magicalness of the fact that simply introducing this turnaround allows us to suddenly deal with two frames, ignore reciprocity, because nevertheless, even in frame one, the twin on Earth can invoke their reciprocity, or in frame two, the twin on Earth can evoke their reciprocity. And somehow, magically, all this has been voided. So clearly, if one twin is now gray and has a long beard, we have a change that is a property of matter. Thus, he argues that special relativity, factoring in this asymmetry associated with the turnaround and the associated acceleration, and due to the fact that a time difference value can be derived due to V, that is, once we get out of the accelerated mode and just start looking at the rocket as moving along at a uniform velocity, then we can apply the Lorentz equations and handle the twin paradox. But yet, he has earlier painstakingly built the case to the point of two Minkowski diagrams that the structure of special relativity demands symmetry, that is reciprocity, and given this symmetry, it does not explain any changes as real properties of matter. So in essence, the entire explanatory burden for aging as a real effect now falls on the asymmetry introduced by the change in inertial frame. But where is this theory, I wonder? That is, where is the theoretical framework supporting how and to what magnitude introducing the symmetry or acceleration affects the physiological processes underlying aging, or why the asymmetry can be introduced into SDR when clearly its structure precludes it, because there's no way to tell who's in motion and who is not? More precisely, where is the theory that explains how introducing an asymmetry now allows the use of the Lorentz equations independent of or outside of this symmetrical reciprocal structure provided in special relativity? And especially when, before Einstein, Lorentz and the use of Lorentz equations to explain any of these things was rejected. Only this reciprocal restructure of Einstein allowed their use. And note too, how, as I noted before, how magical this is. Remember that in the French case, the asymmetry simply allowed him to break the trip up into two frames, frame one and frame two, of uniform motion, and then proceed to compute T prime, showing the retarded aging of the twin in frame one, then the retarded aging of the twin in frame two. The accelerations weren't used. The asymmetry only allowed this sudden usage of the Lorentz equation. And of course, at any time, the rocket twin in frame one could have said, no, I'm not moving, I'm stationary. It's the Earth twin that's moving away from me or toward me, in upsetting the whole apple cart then. So what we have here is not STR. This is not special relativity. This is some other theory, some other thing. It is something that is loaded with magical ad hocs that allow it to explain real physical ontological effects. Comment here, Lorentz was rejected because his contraction seemed ad hoc. At the time, there was no sufficient reason to assume that intermolecular forces that would underlie contracting of an apparatus arm behave the same way as the electromagnetic ones. Though then, later on, Lamora came along and showed that indeed all forces are electromagnetic. But then there was another objection, and if you look at the wiki discussion of this, it kind of trails off into incoherence. Well, if Lorentz was ad hoc, STR is now massively ad hoc. Any old thing can be thrown in to make it quote unquote work. Yes, poor Lorentz. So this is not set well with many people, especially this introduction of all kinds of other things like accelerations, changes of inertial frame. that don't really have any theoretical justification for being thrown into relativity. It's not part of its structure, in fact, mangle its structure into oblivion. So others have argued that the twin effect can be made perfectly constant with SDR. So here's one case. It's Wesley Salmon's argument, sometimes also called the triplets argument. So to stay within the context of the special theory without bringing in gravitational field changes or accelerations, Salmon envisioned a rocket ship A, taking off from Earth, departs from Earth, and it passes another B coming the opposite direction from the star that they're going to. They're coming in direction at the same velocity, so no accelerations are involved. In fact, you could conceive this whole sequence as A simply passing by Earth at a uniform velocity toward the star, and B, the other rocket ship, coming by at a uniform velocity from passing the star and going passing Earth. Nothing but uniform velocities, which is perfectly within special relativity's structure, involved. So at the point of meeting, the two rockets exchange signals to coordinate their clocks. And then B continues on to Earth, where the clocks are compared. And of course, in a triumph of the theory, the Earthbound observer's clock showed a greater passage of time than B. So this seems ironclad. Yet there is a problem. Reciprocity has not been avoided. The observer in A, the rocket A, takes with him his own reference system. Since no reference system is privileged, he has equal right to declare himself at rest and everything else in motion relative to him, including the Earth moving back away from him, the rocket coming toward him, the Earthbound observer's clock, etc. So when B passes A and exchanges signals as to the clock readings, will the signals reflect a retardation of A's time? Will the clock in A be retarded? No, because he's at rest. Only the author of the argument happens to believe A is in motion. In other words, the author of the argument, Salmon, and whoever else is making these arguments, apparently forgot to ask A whether he's in motion. They're assuming the role of omniscient observers that can see and stipulate who's in motion and who is not. Sorry, that doesn't work. They forgot to ask A. When you look at Wiki on the twin paradox, I find it always interesting because of the rather interesting arrogance involved. Quote on the twin paradox: this result appears puzzling because each twin sees the other as moving. And so, according to an incorrect and naive application of time dilation and the principle of relativity, each should paradoxically find the other to have aged more slowly. However, this scenario can be resolved within the standard framework of special relativity. Notice they're saying this is within the standard framework of special relativity. The traveling twin's trajectory involves two different inertial frames, one for the outward journey and one for the inbound journey. And so there is no symmetry between the space-time paths of the twins. Therefore, the twin paradox is not a paradox in the sense of a logical contradiction. No, just not a paradox in the sense of a rather poor set of reasoning. Got to get the rocket in there, I guess. Here's the problem. One frame or two frames, it makes no difference. You are still dealing or treating the time retardation as a different order of effect, that is, as an ontological change, not a measurement effect. Number one, just as you did for the muon in its increased lifespan, just as you did for the half-Lakatian jet-carried clock. and you are still ignoring reciprocity, even on just the outbound path. The observer on Earth has the right to say, no, you're in motion. I'm, you know, or vice versa. The observer on the rocket has the right to say, I'm stationary, and the Earth is moving toward me, and vice versa. You still have an ignored reciprocity. You still have complete inconsistency with respect to the using or treating these orders of effect. You have complete inconsistency. So this is all part of what I'm starting to call reciprocity derangement syndrome. In a review that I have made on Canali's book, I got into a long debate with a person named N.K., and he insisted that French's statement, which I was quoting, namely that the time dilation slash length contractions are not a property of matter, but something inherent in the measurement process, was way overinterpreted by me. In other words, he did not want to admit that the time dilations of the mesons, of the jet-carried clock, of the twin, could only be measurement effects, not real effects. But he would never defend this mere assertion of way interpretation, way over interpretation. So finally, I challenged him at one point to at least affirm or answer the question, well, is the length contraction used to explain Michelson Morley taken as only a measurement effect by physics, SDR? I was starting to get desperate. I was wondering, well, do you even accept that Michelson Morley is a measurement effect only? He finally decided to answer. And he trotted out this long discussion of the scenario. He described a train speeded by a station platform, which you can also find Einstein discussing in his works on relativity. An observer on the platform would see a snake on the train looking through the window as contracted. So the contraction per NK was very real. The snake is indeed contracted. But now notice, he's trying to evade measurement, evade real properties of matter. So he says, but the snake feels no pain. There's no crunching of molecules, no crunching of pain receptors, etc. So that is per NK, it's not real, not ontological. There's no physical reality for Mr. Snake. But there's also the contraction is very real. In other words, this is the desperate attempt to have his cake and eat it too. It never even occurred to him to ask, well, probably Steve will say, but NK, there is the intrinsic reciprocity of SDR. The train being considered at rest, the station moving, this is why it's called relativity. Thus, an observer on the at-rest train will see a snake in the station as the station is speeding slash moving by as similarly contracted. Which snake contraction then is real? And the answer obviously is that neither contraction is any actual reality. There is no crunching of molecules, no squishing of atoms, no firing of pain receptors in Mr. Snake, and in the time case, no slowing down of his physiological processes. This is why there is, quote, no pain. It is not an ontological, real physical effect. That is, yes, it is not a property of matter. It is a measurement effect with no more reality than my expando toaster. Now, I hate to say this, but the beginning of the rejection of reciprocity, the intuition that we don't really need reciprocity, which I see rampant in physics writers on special relativity, really began with Einstein in 1905. So earlier we saw where in his 1905 paper, Einstein described the reciprocity. That is, a sphere that's normally a sphere at rest is seen as an ellipsoid in the moving system, and vice versa. The situation changes. Sphere becomes ellipsoid, ellipsoid becomes sphere in each system. But it doesn't take him two paragraphs from this point when he notes a peculiar consequence. Were two synchronous separated clocks, A and B, in the stationary system. So there's my two clocks. in the stationary system, both showing 3 o'clock. And if A is moved to B with velocity V in time t, so we're moving it, it will lag behind B by 1/2 tv squared over c squared. So what's happening here is he's ascribing a real change simply to velocity. Just like all time retardation, just like the mesons, just like the half-life heating clock. This already started there. The structure of reciprocity is already being voided here. We are dealing only with an effect in the stationary system, not relating the two systems. The observer in the stationary system can simply move the clock from A to B to fulfill Einstein's condition, and the effect is simply ascribed to V. The desire to attribute change simply to velocity was already inherent within Monsieur Einstein. This conclusion is quickly reinforced within one more paragraph. Einstein extending this to quote curvilinear motion states flatly that this result implies that a clock at the equator must go more slowly by a small amount than one situated at the poles. Again, what we have here is two clocks in the same system, the Earth system in this case. Note my 1 o'clock at the pole is 2 o'clock, but the one at the equator is 3 o'clock. A little, it's retarded compared to the one at the equator. Physicists accept this equatorial clock retardation naturally as a real effect. By the way, I'm overblowing that effect there by that's not an hour, but they accepted clock retardation naturally as a real effect. The effect had to be factored into the half-life heating jet-carried clock. Yet reciprocity demands the Earth be stationary. The observer is spinning around. I guess it's hard to even quite get reciprocity in this case. But now it would not be a real effect. This is likely not very tasteful to physics, because how do you deny again that it's not a real effect? You simply have to put your head in the sand about reciprocity and say, oh, it went away somewhere. This is doubly reinforced because the equator clock is an exact analog to Einstein's future thought experiment, which helps introduce the general theory, the thought experiment of the rotating disk, where again, clock retardation just due to, in this case, the acceleration of the rotating disk, which is no different from the Earth there, as a real effect. We'll see this shortly. So this is Bergson's position. And what I've been doing here is simply unfolding the arguments in duration and simultaneity while simultaneously bringing them up to speed in terms of current thought, findings, etc. So the position is, as our rocket goes by, neither twin ages more slowly. The flow of time is invariant for both. This is the implication of reciprocity and the structure of special relativity. All changes have to be treated as measurement effects. This is the true, consistent interpretation of STR. Special relativity is not describing real ontological effects, nor can it be used to explain real ontological effects. So what is the consistent STR that is consistent with respect to its logical theoretical structure? One, fundamental reciprocity. Any observer can declare himself at rest, all the rest in motion with respect to him. Two, the effects are of the same order. In relating the at-rest system to the moving system, necessarily both time units and space units change in the moving system, where time unit expansions intrinsically, mathematically, compensate for space unit contractions. Thus, the changes are necessarily of the same order. Given the reciprocity, these changes can only be measurement effects. Four, the Michelson-Morley experiment is explained within the structure, that is, special relativities, as a measurement effect only. the apparatus arm's length contraction, not an actual ontological change. 5, the twin paradox should be equally explained as such, only a measurement effect with no actual age slowing involved, since time unit changes are equally necessarily only measurement effects too. What's the inconsistent STR, where the logical theoretical structure is ignored or violated? 1, the reciprocity is ignored or even denied. Example, the rocket twin. In the rocket twin, the Lorentz transformation is applied for T prime. His time units expand, he ages less, arrives back at Earth younger, end of story. The fact that he could have declared himself stationary, the Earth twin to be in motion, thus the twin Earth twin ages less, thus posing the unavoidable question, who actually ages less? This is ignored. The inescapable fact that time unit changes and space unit changes must be of the same order is ignored. Example, the lifespan increase of a muon traveling at high velocity is held to be very real, ontological. Yet it is necessarily only a measurement effect, just as the Michelson-Morley apparatus arm contraction. Yet the Michelson-Morley arm contraction is held to be only a measurement effect. The muon lifespan increase or the slowed clock on half the Keating's jet are very real, ontological, complete inconsistency. 3, the reciprocity is ignored, version 2. Accelerations are introduced for the rocket twin, but the systems are said to be indistinguishable. This is why anyone can say he is at rest, the other's in motion. No one can tell, yet accelerations change all this. The theory is now in reality inapplicable, and there's no theory as to why you can induce accelerations. 4, third version of reciprocity being ignored. As I noted in the twin triplets case, or in Salmon's version thereof, when B, returning from a star, passes A, A on his outward journey, and B takes a reading from A's supposedly slowed clock, he forgot to ask A whether A thinks he is moving. A thinks he is at rest, rightly slow. Again, rightly so. Again, the argument fails to see where the reciprocity comes in, just ignores it. So, in 1924, in Revue Philosophique, and you can see Bergson, The Evolution for Physics by Gunter for this, Bergson and a physicist named André Metz had a short ongoing debate in written form. You had Metz writing an article on relativity, Bergson making a response, then Metz making a response, then Bergson making a response, and then he quit. Metz could not understand why special relativity could not explain the muons. He just couldn't understand why Bergson said that STR was not capable of explaining. Again, it came back to the fact that Bergson was saying, hey, you can only explain measurement effects. It can't explain real effects. You need some other theory. But clearly, Metz could conceive of no other form of explanation other than STR. So Bergson gave up. So let's see if we can help Metz. Let's see if we can do slowing of aging or increase lifespans without special relativity. I'm going to give an example here what a theory of actual processes might look like. I'm not saying it is the theory, it's simply an example of how you would make a theory of actual processes, not just abstract mathematics that are applied improperly anyhow to this phenomena. So J.J. Thompson, circa the 1920s, argued that an electron is a special case of an electric current. An electric current generates a counter EMF or secondary counter EMF opposite its motion. The faster the current, the greater the counter electromagnetic motive force, okay, EMF. So counter electromotive force. Until the resistance is so great, the current can move no faster. So in other words, the greater the current, the faster the current, the greater the EMF, counter EMF, until you get the resistance so great, the current can't move any faster. So this is the limiting velocity of the current. It's a singularity. It's not like the limiting case for the speed of light. The same thing is true for a single electron. You know, it put in motion, it generates its own counter EMF, and its resistance is, in actuality, its mass, until it hits a point of singularity. The mass is so great, it cannot move or increase anymore. Now, Jacob Kessler, in a little self-published book called The Energy of Space in 1962, argued that a meson is a group of positrons and electrons. Now, he noted that a positron-electron pair annihilates itself. The positron, he argued, accepts energy from the electron, and it's a particle such that it radiates that energy away into the ether. So that is, the electron-positron pair has a lifespan until it lasts until it annihilates itself, till all the energy is radiated away. Now, a meson group consists of, say, three electrons and two positrons or other such numbers, and they will get in a synchrony where they will feed each other. They feed each energy, but eventually the energy is dissipating away into the ether. So the time it takes for the complete dissipation is its lifespan. But put the meson group now in motion, then the counter EMF retards their rotation, because the faster they move, the slower they're going to, the faster they're put in motion, the slower their rotation is going to be. And the radiation away of energy is then slowed down. So the lifespan of the meson is increasing. The greater the velocity, the greater the increase of lifespan. So there's no magical appeal here to magical changes of time or of time units here, simply due to the motion of observers. There's no need for SDR to explain this. What we have is a process model of the increase of lifespan of mesons or muons. So I'm not saying, again, this is the model. I'm just trying to give an example to break the mindset that only special relativity and its abstract motions of observers and changes of measurement units, which should purely be measurement effects in the first place, is the only way to explain these increases of lifespan, or retardations of clock, for that matter. Having been talking about breaking the mindset that only SDR can explain things like time retardations, it hit me that I'll surely get asked, well, how about EMC squared? Don't we need special relativity for that? And the fact is, there are other derivations hanging around of this equation. You don't need special relativity. It even falls out of Thomson's model that we just discussed, his model of the electron. And these derivations I'm looking at, I'm thinking about, are actual physical models of the conversion of mass to energy, an actual process model, not just something that abstractly falls out of the abstract mathematics, as it did in Einstein's case. And we should note, in reality, SDR's reciprocity structure isn't needed in any case either for this. Technically, I think it simply falls out of the Lorentz equations in the first place. We have seen the appeal to acceleration in the twin case to explain the paradox. Part of this comes from the fact that acceleration in Einstein's framework has gained a special status. It's a form of force, an actual form of absolute. This is why it supposedly retards processes, though no theory is given for this. It came from a thought experiment with Einstein where he derived what he called the principle of equivalence. In this experiment, he thought of being in an elevator, and as the elevator starts up, it accelerates, and I feel a jolt like a force. And in Einstein's thinking, this was like gravity, this feeling of a force. And so acceleration gained the status of a force, equivalent to gravity. Bergson made the point very simply that acceleration could not possibly have the status Einstein gives it. He made this simple, and only Bergsonian could do this point. Velocity is the rate of change of position. It's the first derivative with respect to time. What's acceleration? It's simply the rate of change of the rate of change of position. So think about this for a moment. What's the difference here, other than one's the rate of change of the rate of change? How could the second derivative suddenly gain such a privileged position over the first as a virtual force? Further, Bergson noted, if we cannot derive the Lorentz equation for t prime in the context of accelerations, we have undercut all calculus and physics. And indeed, Lin Zhan Wang performed exactly this derivation, t prime in the context of accelerating systems. If you search Wang clock paradox, you'll find it. What does this mean? It means that we are right back to reciprocity. Invoking accelerations for the twin changes nothing. We simply obtain t prime in each case, whether the rocket twin is moving with accelerations or whether the Earth twin is moving with accelerations, it makes no difference. The flow of time is still invariant to both. Further, Bergson noted in matter and memory, force is indeed equally relative in the first place. It cannot have the absolute status that Einstein is giving it. Force is a function of acceleration, F equal ma. That is, this is simply an invariance law, as physics is careful to treat it. But we have seen just now that acceleration is simply a function of the rate of change of position. That is, a function of relative motion. Remember, and we talked about the continuum of points of positions, and you can have an object, say our cup, and you can move it across the continuum, or you can move the continuum underneath the object. It's relative. It's the ultimate in relative motion. So it's simply change of position. You cannot be expressing real motion by this mathematical convention. So force is a function of relative motion. So force itself, one with these relative movements, is equally fully relative. It cannot have the absolute status that Einstein gives it, or that twin paradox resolvers give it either. So we come to the rotating disk experiment that was also a thought experiment initiating GTR. Again, this is where acceleration gained special status. It's also flawed, as Bergson noted. In the experiment, or in the thought experiment, an observer is on a rotating disk. Note it's accelerating. And so by rotation, we mean the rim we can see is accelerating around. As he moves from the center along a radius toward the perimeter of the disk, his clock increasingly slows. But, said Bergson, again, remembering reciprocity, the observer takes with him his own reference system. He's at rest. The disk rim is moving towards him. Einstein forgot reciprocity. Now, don't think of the observer walking. That just abstractly moving. That's all Einstein and relativity ask for. When you start thinking of the walking, you start thinking of real motion. But relativity is inherently abstract. So he's simply moving abstractly toward the rim, or the rim is moving toward him. It's the same problem as Salmon and the triplets when rocket A passed rocket B. We forgot to ask the observer whether or not he's moving or not. So let's make some conclusions to this point. Firstly, STR cannot be used to explain real ontological time-related effects, not the muons, not Halfley Keating, not the twins, not Brad Pitt, not anything ontological. Special relativity's reciprocity structure, inherent reciprocity structure, and the fact that distance and time effects have to be of the same order preclude this explanatory usage. The famous conformations of STR, then, are simply invalid usages of the theory. Yet these phenomena or effects due to velocity, the retarded aging of muons, the slowed clock on the jet, clearly exist. Therefore, there is another theory needed, a new theory required for explanation of these effects. Further, and I'll add this in as a conclusion in a non-Bergsonian way, for I would note that Bergson was extremely deferential to the physics, in the physics community, and in the entirety of duration and simultaneity, was simply trying to get them to clarify their own theory more precisely and its implications. But I'm going to say at this point that I think that STR explains Michelson Morley is extremely doubtful as well as time has passed. The implications of the Pohl-Bohn paradox, for example, which we just barely poked our nose into, already show that real ontological effects are likely involved even for length changes. For example, as we noted, we could easily make the pole do something to the barn that is now an ontological effect that cannot be undone by reciprocity. Further, there are Michelson and Morley related experiments, and by Michelson and Morley related experiments, I mean experiments related to detecting the motion of the Earth, detecting the motion of the ether, for example, the Sagnac experiment, Airy's failure, that STR could not possibly explain given its structure. And I would advise you avoid the wiki narrative on these, because the wiki narrative is devoted to defending the status quo and somewhat obscuring the implications of some of these experiments. So I think it unavoidable to say at this point in time, many years later from Bergson, that STR is a failed theory. So next we're going to deal with more on the space-time block, why there must be true simultaneity. The Bergson-Einstein exchange I mentioned took place in 1922, and the implications for STR versus the temporal metaphysic. I'm leading here with this quote from James J. Gibson: "Physicists mislead us when they say there's no simultaneity. When the camera pans to the heroine tied to the rails and then to the hero rushing to the rescue on his horse, these events are simultaneous." And Bergson's coincident remark: "The theoreticians of relativity never mention any simultaneity but that of two instants." So we'll unpack this later. Down the road, we still got free will, voluntary action, implications of education, quantum mechanics, if I can indeed come forth with some brilliant insights. So next time, Einstein and relativity, part B. And we're not talking Medicare part B here, but scientific theory. So till then.